We have to give you that belt.
Good morning. We'll welcome folk a little bit later, but won't you stand with me just so that we can enter into some worship. I'm just going to read a psalm. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. But who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Only the one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God, their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek his face. God of Jacob, lift up your heads, you gates, and be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Amen.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Father, we lift up our heads to you this morning. We lift up and we open the doors of our hearts to you. We open the doors of this church and this community and this family that you may come in. Help us to know this morning, Jesus, who is this King of glory. Help us to know that you are a glorious King, not an average King. You supersede all kings. They're like shadows in your midst. We pray today, Lord, we would just see your lordship and your kingship, and we would truly exalt you in our worship. We pray this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
And
Of what it is
I think our flesh can get in the way. And what I get a sense is just as a congregation. Some might be here, but some might be here, but not here. Because you've got so many things going on. I get it. We all live with a little bit of distraction. I just feel there's a bit of a barrier in our worship. You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals. Because you were slain, with your blood, you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You made them to be a kingdom of priests to serve our God. And they will reign on the earth. Then I looked, said John, and I heard the voice of many angels. numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. Imagine that scene. And they encircled the throne, and the living creatures and the elders. And in a loud voice, because he is worthy, they were saying and singing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Worthy is the Lamb." In a loud voice, they sang. I don't care how good your voice is. It makes no difference to me. But can we sing that again? As if he is worthy, because he is worthy. Should we do that? And let's worship him with our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. For he is worthy. Let's, can we sing that again?
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. Universe declares your majesty. You are
Malibu, Children, why a heart of stone? Why has the fountain dried up? I don't hear your praise. Has the incense stopped being offered in the temple? For you I died. For you I rent the veil of the temple in two, that you might enter into the Holy of Holies. Why this heart of stone this morning? Why are you not able to praise my name with your heart? Would you care only for yourself? Or would you care for the cross of Calvary? Lift up your voice and sing.
Yes, Lord.
Let the spirit of living water flow from your belly, for I have given it to you. Lift up your hearts and rejoice, for I, the Lord, have purchased you a great salvation. The angels of heaven and the saints of old fall before me and worship me. Would you not do this too? And see the blessing that I can pour out upon you. Let me replace that heart of stone this morning with the heart of Christ, saith the Lord.
Who breaks the power of sin?
is mighty, is so much stronger. The King of glory, the King of our shakes the whole with holy thunder. Who needs his breath in all and wonder? The King of glory, the King of the whole king. This is amazing grace. This is a
worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
His unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free.
Says, I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated, embarrassed in my own eyes. I don't mind being embarrassed, I've done that many times. But I don't know how to be embarrassing to myself. That's another level. But that led up to this, and this is a response to what Eric was saying, what God was saying through you, Eric. Verse 20, it says, when David returned home to bless his household, Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, how the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, going around half naked in full view of the slave girls of his servants. How can you do that? How can you go around? It's embarrassing. David said to her, it was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone from his house, when you appointed me the ruler over the Lord's people of Israel. I will celebrate before the Lord. And then he says, I will become even more undignified than this. And I will be humiliated in my own eyes. Because you are celebrating and praising God. He wasn't showing off his naked body to the girls. He wasn't trying to embarrass anybody. He was responding to what the Lord just said through Eric. He's saying, I don't care. I don't care. I don't want to say this. I don't have front teeth. The day that COVID started, I had an accident and my teeth broke off. My voice has been silent for 2 years in my heart because I'm embarrassed. I'm scared. What will they say? You ain't like a Cape Townian. Nothing wrong with him, don't be offended. But I'm embarrassed by that. And God said to me, I will restore your mouthpiece. He didn't say my teeth will grow back. He said, I will restore your mouthpiece. Because like many before you, if you say what I say, people will hear my voice, not yours. And then David said, I'm not here to entertain you. Rory's not here to entertain us. Lindsay and the guys are not here to entertain you, church. They're here to help us walk into the fullness of God's glory.
Amen.
The angels, as Rory said, they were covering their faces when they said, exalted be God. Exalted. They were honoring him. So when God is saying through here, guys, what happened to your hearts? Why is your hearts hard this morning? We have a choice. We can respond. And we can say, oh, no, that's not for me. Or we can say, Lord, I'm sorry. Come and melt my heart before you. Use my mouth, whether it looks like whatever, whether I sound like an angel or a dog, horse, whatever, I don't know what the right words are, not a demon. But I will sing to you. I will sing to you. I will make the noises that I've got. I will groan to you if I have to. But you are worthy of my praise, not my silence. The rocks will cry out. Really goes away, I can still speak. So Father, I pray that as we enter into the rest of this morning, that our heart attitude would change, that our posture would change, Lord, But our focus will not be on our voices or on the noise that we make, but it will be on our hearts that is singing to you. So that when we walk out of here, we lift your name, our Father. Not our own ideas and passions and dreams, but you are at the forefront. So Jesus, we respond to you. Say, forgive us, Lord, for hardening our hearts. Help us to be a little bit undignified. Some of you, in closing, and some of you need to take off that old cloak, like the prodigal son, that smells like pig. Take it off. And allow the Holy Spirit to come and give you the new cloak.
Please, won't you take a seat?
Thank you, worship team. I just feel we plan for the morning has changed. We normally follow with a few announcements and taking up the offering. But we're going to switch that. We're going to do that at the end. And we're just going to go straight into the preach because I feel God is dealing with something this morning. I don't know if you can, it's kind of a holy moment, and sometimes in these moments, you know, it can feel a little bit weighty. And sometimes we need to embrace that weightiness and just allow God to do what He's doing.
Amen.
And so I feel just to go straight into sharing what we're going to share this morning. And then what I do feel what we're going to do straight after is we're going to worship again. But I feel there'll be a totally different. When we worship again, it's going to be different.
Yeah, good.
You know, God speaks through His people. Eric cried out the belly of his soul there. And it's an exhortation to you now. Do you know what exhortation is? It's like, it's more than an encouragement. It's something that should stir us.
Yeah.
And our hearts should go, yes, and amen. And then Hendrik has a word, and I know Kerry's got something that will lead us into that worship as well. And so I feel in between, let's just lean in. I don't know if you've ever found that on occasions you have something that's in the future that's going to be a big event for you. I don't know, imagine something where you've had something that's going to be a big event. Maybe an interview. Maybe it's a wedding day. Or maybe it's just something every now and again in our lives, we have these significant events. And then we talk about them, and it's easy to talk about these events. Maybe it's a big race or something. And you talk about them, you plan it, and you talk to your friends about it. And then suddenly, the eve before, it sets in. Hey, this is on our doorstep. This is tomorrow. And you wake up in the morning, hey, it's today. And if you ever had those knots, it's like the event has arrived. You've talked about it, you've planned for it, and now you stand before it. And you have every reason to maybe back up because you might think it's too much for you. But you start to get that knot. This is Jesus' event. This is where He stands before. I want you to get a sense of what's going through his stomach at this particular time.
Sure.
We're looking at some key events. We dealt with the Passover. Today we're going to deal with the story of where Jesus takes his disciple up from that amazing fellowship meal. And he starts to enter into a moonlit garden where there's glimmers of moonlight coming through. And he enters into a garden called Gethsemane. And as he enters into this garden, he goes deeper and deeper and deeper into the garden. And Gethsemane means olive press. And it's quite a good metaphor because in an olive press, what would happen is in these press is these olives would get crushed and squeezed. And out of them would come this most valuable oil. And as he gets deeper into the garden, what you're going to begin to see is that he begins to be squeezed even more and more as he goes deeper into the garden. And so we're going to read from Matthew chapter 26. The passage won't be on the screen, the full passage, but I will break it up verse by verse on the screen. And then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." Then he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." And going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and he found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." And when he came back, he found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. And so he left them and he went away once more and prayed a third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to his disciples and he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come. The Son of Man is to be delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." What we're going to look at today is just three things. Number one is you're going to see the enormity, the agony and the anguish that comes upon Jesus as he enters into this garden. Sorry, is this coming through fine?
Perfect. Yeah.
Perfect. The second thing you're going to see is how immediate that in this moment, the immediacy of the agony that comes upon him. And lastly, just to close off, we're going to see what difference does that make to you and I. In verse 36 there, and 37, it says he takes his disciples, and you'll see the imagery of it. He moves from being in a place of fellowship out of the Passover meal. He comes out, he starts to move into the garden, and then he leaves some of the disciples, and he takes the three who were closest to him, and he moves deeper into the garden. And so there would be him and the three, and then he tells them to watch and pray, and then he moves even deeper into the garden where he's alone. So what he's moving is from fellowship, and he gets increasingly isolated until he's alone. He's moving from a place of light into increasing darkness. And there's these words there that the gospel writer Matthew writes. It says, something began as he moved. Not that we're all English gurus, but it's a present progressive verb. In other words, as he moved, something came upon him. So much so that the Son of God, the one who walked on water, cast out a legion of demons and calmed the hurricane, is face down in the dust. Such was the magnitude, the enormity, and the power of this thing that came upon him. Jesus himself said he's in anguish until he's feeling sorrowful, troubled, even to the point of death. Emotionally, spiritually, mentally, physically, he's not able to stand. And he staggers and he falls under the weight of this thing. B.B. Warfield said that word where he says he is troubled. The true interpretation is he's horrified. It's not just I'm troubled, he's horrified. There's horror that has come upon him. The gospel writer Mark says he's astonished. And such is the weight and the crushing of this thing that is coming upon him, that begins to come upon him. The gospel writer Luke, who was a doctor, says, when he returned to speak to his disciples, they noticed that his sweat was colored. There was drops of blood mixed with his sweat. He wasn't just sweating. He had a true condition going on called hematidrosis. And it occurs often on death row with people who have been sentenced to death. And in the hours before their execution, they stand before that moment. And they often get hematidrosis, where blood gets mixed with their sweat because of the stress and the shock and the horror of what's about to transpire. Soldiers plan their wars, but when the moment comes, when they step onto the battlefield, they've been known to get hematidrosis because of the shock and the horror of what they're about to go into. And this passage, this thing that came upon him to see the Son of God, the Mighty One, reveling in the dust, has puzzled many a thoughtful reader. Was it something new information that he had suddenly just realized? It's like, oh gee, I really have to die? He had spoken with his disciples all about his death. He knew very well. He knew how, when, and why he was going to die. He knew it. So it wasn't some kind of new information for him. Like, surprise, you really are going to die. And you know, throughout history, hundreds if not thousands of people have died for their faith, for the name of Jesus. And they've died with better peace and poise than the Son of God reveling in the dust. Stephen, a young man, martyred, stoned, died with a smile on his face. Acts 8, because he saw heaven opened. Peter said, no, don't crucify me like Jesus. Put me upside down because I'm not worthy to be crucified in the same way he was crucified. In the 1860s, I think it was, Hugh Latimer and Nicholas Ridley died for their faith. They were burned at the stake in the Oxford High Street. Burned at the stake. And Hugh Latimer says to Nicholas Ridley, I'll read it to you. Look at the peace and poise he dies with. Be of good cheer, Master Ridley. Play the man. For we shall this day light such a candle in England as I trust by God's grace shall never be put out. Good day, old chap. Let's just die and light a flame for England, I say. Such peace and such poise. Here you find the Son of God in the dust. What was the difference? What was the difference? What was this thing that came upon him that was so weighty that put him into the dust? And the enormity of it is what we need to understand. And so what was it? Well, when we read the passage, let's read it again. And it's going to give us some clues. It was the cup. Three times he speaks about the cup. Going a little further, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, is it possible? May this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time. "My Father, is it not possible for this cup to be taken away? Unless I drink it, may your will be done." And then he goes back a third time and he says the same things. He refers to the cup 3 times. So all commentators, or all worthy commentators, should I say, would agree that the cup refers to the judicial wrath of God on all human evil. If your commentator does not say that, then throw away that commentary and get a good one. Because there is a teaching today that has an issue with the idea that God can be a wrathful God. We just want in our hearts a all-sweet, loving God who will just deny that there is human evil. Because that makes it much easier for us. The cup described the judicial, the judging wrath of God on all human evil. How did they get to the metaphor of a cup? Well, in ancient days, what they used to do to execute a few people is they would make a poison, a concoction of all sorts of ingredients, and then they would make this person drink this poison, and it would kill them slowly from the inside out. In other words, it would eat their insides. It would just totally begin to emulsify every kind of organ and digestive thing in their stomach and eventually kill them. Hugely painful. The most famous of these executed was Socrates. That's how he died. By emulsification of his insides by drinking a concocted cup. The Hebrew prophets would pick up on this and you would have writings. From Isaiah 51, "He shall drink the cup of fury and stagger." Ezekiel 23, "He will drink the cup of ruin and desolation, and it will tear his breasts." And so as Jesus drinks the cup, or the cup gets set before him, suddenly the enormity and the weight of what's about to transpire comes upon him. You know, just on a side note, with regards to the wrath of God, is many people don't want to believe in a God who can be wrathful, or a God who is holy. But the truth about God that we serve, he's a loving God, which you will see in these next few minutes as to how loving he is. But he's a holy God and he's a just God. Because if he's not just, then he cannot be God. And if he is just, then evil and sin needs to be judged. And the choice you're going to need to make today is either Jesus is going to drink the cup for you, or you're going to drink the cup. The cup of judgment. Sobering, isn't it? But if we believe in a God who judges human evil, and if we take away the wrath of God, what we actually have is a God who loves us in a very general way. Let me explain. Because if God puts his son in our place, what we've got to see is the cost that he paid in order for us to be accepted by him. His love is so great that he would send his son to drink a cup in our place. You see, if we take out this area of judging human evil, what we actually have is a God who loves us genuinely. But if we believe the truth about the Bible is that God will judge human evil and sin, we now have a God who loves us at great cost. How much more costly is it begins to describe and show us how great this love truly is. Does that make sense? It actually demonstrates to us how deep this love is for you and I. And what Jesus is beginning to experience in the garden here is to make it clear as we need to understand how God sometimes... Oh dear, is that load shedding?
Load shedding.
No problem.
Might be better just to carry on.
I'm going to carry on. I'd like to, Clarence, just to get it rigged up for the worship, if that's okay. Maybe just turn that off.
Otherwise, it's going to make a noise.
Okay, we ready to go again?
Speak like a sergeant major.
Okay, so to help make this clear, what Jesus is beginning to experience in the garden is we also need to understand how God sometimes punishes sin or disciplines people. So sometimes it's in a way which is kind of like poetic justice. And what that means is, let's take the example of Jonah. God calls Jonah to go to the Ninevites. Jonah says, no, because my heart has the natural tendency to do what it wants. The heart, Gary's heart, my heart, everybody's heart, wants to do what it wants. It has the natural tendency to do things our way, not necessarily God's way. And so Jonah says, no, I don't want to go to the Ninevites. I actually want to go to Tarshish. I don't want to go to Joburg. I want to go to Cape Town. And so I'm going to do what I want to do, when I want to do it, and how I want to do it. And so God says, okay, let's leave Jonah to himself and see how that goes. What happens to Jonah? Very soon, there's sunny skies. He's thinking this is amazing, but imminently there's clouds brewing on the horizon. He finds himself in a storm and then ultimately in the belly of a fish. That's doing things your own way and not God's way. That's ultimately where we find ourselves, in very lonely, dark spaces. The prodigal son says to the father, I want my inheritance now because my heart wants to do what it wants to do. So please can I have my inheritance, and I'm going to go and do and live my life how I want to do it. God says, okay, let's cut you loose and off you go. Let's leave you to yourself and see how that goes. Off the prodigal son goes. Where does he find himself? Soon enough, he runs out of resources. You want to live life without God? Ultimately, you're going to run out of resources. You're going to run out of breath. Your body's going to begin to waste away. You will run out of resources. Initially, you might think, this is wonderful. I have loads of breath and money and talents and time. I'm just living my life. But ultimately, the story of the prodigal son will show you where you will end ultimately. Unless you return to your father. You see? God leaves people to themselves to sometime, like that prodigal, bring them to their senses. And Jonah, it was in the belly of a fish, in the bottom of the sea. They come to their senses and they return to the will of God and say, your will is good and pleasing. Let me come to your will. And so how does this relate to where we are now in the story of Jesus? Well, what you find, this is Jesus' hour of greatest need. This is his moment. He knows what lies before him. He knows what's coming in the next few hours. He had good friends. Comes back to his friends and what they do. Sleeping. Falling asleep on him. So he's alone. But with Jesus, what you'll notice right throughout the Gospels is that doesn't bother him. Because who does he turn to? His Father. He's always got his Father.
So if his friends are falling asleep in him, it doesn't matter because I've got my Father. He loves me. He's the one who believes in me. He's the one who's my source of life. I'm tied to him. And as he enters the garden three times, he prays. And what is he finding? As the weight of the sin of the world is going to be put on him, he turns to his Father. And what he's finding is he has been forsaken. He is beginning to be forsaken so that we could be accepted. I'm going to read two commentators' quotes. You won't see them on the screen because... But I want you to have to listen very carefully. Commentator Bill Lane. The dreadful sorrow and anxiety then out of which the prayer for which the passing of the cup springs is not an expression of fear before a dark destiny or shrinking from the prospect of the physical suffering and death. It is rather the horror of one who lives wholly for the Father, who came to be with the Father for an interlude before his betrayal, and found hell rather than heaven open before him. Jonathan Edwards put it this way: the agony of Christ, the agony that Christ is experiencing in the garden, was caused by a vivid, bright, full, immediate view of the wrath of God. God the Father, as it were, set the cup down before him, which was vastly more terrible than Nebuchadnezzar's furnace. He now had a near view of that furnace into which he was about to be cast. He stood and he viewed its raging flames, the glowing of its heat, that he might know where he was going and what he was to suffer. You get the picture. There's the cup that was going to emulsify him from the inside out. And what God has done is put this before him. And he turns to find his Father and finds nothing. He finds an abyss. He finds hell open before him. Something like Nebuchadnezzar's furnace on steroids, set before him. It's no wonder why Stephen could die in the book of Acts, where he sees heaven open before him. Because when Christ died, the moment before he faced his martyr, he saw hell open before him. Peter saw heaven open before him. Nicholas Ridley and Hugh Latimer, they were able to see heaven open before him, for them. Because Christ saw hell and the raging flames open before him when he was martyred. You see the difference? You see why he's staggering? His breasts are literally being torn apart from the inside out. I don't know about you, but this kind of scene, if you close your eyes and you just imagine it, I almost feel my breast being torn a bit. It makes me weak at the knees. I can only imagine what it would be like for him. So to answer the question, do you see the enormity
of what's coming upon him in that moment. The next thing is, why now? The immediacy of it. Why now? Why would God, in this preluding moment, reveal the cup to him now and say, son, this is what you're going to have to do. For them, the guys sleeping, who represent the human race, this is what you're going to have to do. This is the furnace you're going to have to walk into. Why would God not just, in a fleeting moment, make him drink it on the cross? Why set it before him now? Jonathan Edwards again would write this. Christ was going to be cast into a dreadful furnace of wrath, and it was not proper that he should plunge himself into it blindfolded. As not knowing how dreadful the furnace was, therefore God brought it before him and set him at the mouth of the furnace, that he might look in and stand and view its fierce, raging flames, and he might see where he was going, and might voluntarily enter into it and bear it for sinners, as knowing what it was. It's a difference, isn't there? And Christ had a choice to make in this moment. The best of them were sleeping. The best of us were sleeping. Will you do it for them? How much more infinitely and wonderful is the love and the choice he made, knowing what it was? And not just thrust on him on the cross. Yet he still chooses. I will do it. I will do it. And there's two things he does in the garden. He loves the Lord his God with all his heart, soul, mind, and his strength that he has. And he loves his neighbor as himself. We'll begin with the second. Look who he loves as himself. Three times he comes back. And he sees Peter, James, and John. They represent us, the human race, asleep. And all he wants is, how human is this? Will you just watch and pray with me? I'm not asking you to encourage me. Come on, Jesus, you're doing so well. What a savior, what a Lord. There's nothing coming out of their mouths. He's not even asking it. Will you just watch and stay awake and pray with me? And every time he comes back, he finds them asleep. That's a picture of the human race. Asleep. Not lightened to the things of God. Asleep. And God says, will you do it for them? And he loves his neighbor. He loves them in spite of their slumber. He says, in actual fact, they're going to be awakened. The human race is going to be awakened by this great love. I'm going to bring them out of their slumber. I'm going to enlighten them. I'm going to bring them out of their deceit. I'm going to bring them out of their sleep and awaken them to a new life and a new kingdom. And he loves his God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength. Imagine what this took. He did not have to do it. He did not have to do it. He could have quite frankly just said, no thank you, gone back to the throne of heaven, and left us to our own devices. But he said, no. Can you take this cup from me? The Father said, there's no other way. There is no other way. Somebody has to drink the cup. It's going to be you or it's going to be them, or I'm not a just God. And Jesus said, I will love them and I will love you with all my heart, soul,
mind, and strength, because I know what your will is, to awaken me. You know, in the Bible, when God says, if you obey me, he says to Adam in the Garden of Eden, if you obey me, you will live. If you obey me about this tree, you will live. Abraham, if you obey me, I will bless you. All throughout the Bible, what you'll find is with obedience comes reward and blessing. Amen. Would you agree?
Amen.
To Jesus, if you obey me with this one, I will destroy you. If you obey me about this tree, I will destroy you. You will be destroyed on it. You see, obedience, there's a motivation with our obedience, isn't there? Because there's a reward and there's a blessing. And there's a promise that's attached to it. What I want you to see here is the purest and most finest obedience.
Amen.
Just to the Father's will.
Amen.
Knowing that he would be destroyed on it. This is true and the finest of obedience.
That's right.
Just to the Father's will. Absolute trust in the will of the Father. No promise attached to it. The only promise is if you take this cup, it will kill you. And he said, yes, I will. Yes, I will. How great is that love?
Amen.
See, what you see is the first Adam. If you obey me about this tree, you will live eternally. To the second Adam, Jesus, if you obey me about this tree, it's going to destroy you. Sin and death came into this world, and human evil, and the world got fractured and broken in a garden. And the great reversal and salvation and redemption comes into the world in a garden. Where the second Adam, the true Adam, is faithful and true to the will of the Father when he obeys about a tree. You see, what you have in the garden and on the cross is not just a dying savior. You have a doing savior. A savior who is earning a righteousness for you and I, that is unmatchable, is priceless. It's priceless. An obedience to the will of the Father that no man has ever been able to do. It is the highest level and most purest form of obedience, making him righteous above all else. So what is he earning for you and I? Holiness, perfection, righteousness. Not only do we have a dying Savior who's consuming the wrath of God on our behalf, but a doing Savior who's earning for us a righteousness that no man could ever attain to. And in 2 Corinthians 5 it said, he made him to be sin. The sin of the world has been transferred onto him so that we might become the righteousness of God. The divine exchange was about to take place. That we could stand before God pure, righteous, holy, having that righteousness imputed to us and our sin put on him. And he drinks the cup for you and for I. If, just imagine this for a moment. Jonathan Edwards' description is God put this cup before him and he got a whiff of it. Just a whiff. Just a smell of this concoction, this judgment, this wrath. This thing was going to emulsify him. He got a whiff of it and it put the Son of God flat in the dust. Just a whiff.
Can you imagine what it was like on the cross when he was draining the cup? Of the horror that he was going through. If this is the horror just of a whiff in the garden. Do you want to know how resolute our Savior is? Is on that cross, he cried one thing. I want to speak about two things. Number one is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is God turned away as the sin of the world came on him? Now you understand what it means to be forsaken. He turned to his Father and found nothing but hell before him. But the other astonishing thing he says on the cross is he cries, it is finished.
Amen.
He drained every last drop of that cup of the wrath of God, the judgment on all human evil. And if you see that, if you see it, there's only one cup you will drink. It's the cup of festival joy at the great wedding feast. You will drink the cup of festival joy at the great wedding feast. And you have a choice to make in your life, and God's given you this window in your lifetime to be able to choose which cup do you want to drink at the end of your days. Because there are only two cups. You will either see Jesus for who he is and what he's done for you and how great is his love.
Amen.
That he would love you to the nth degree to choose to drink a cup of God's judgment on all human evil, that you may drink the cup of festival joy even when you are sleeping. And that kind of love will awaken your soul.
Yes.
For he is worthy to be praised.
Amen.
And you will drink the cup of festival joy.
Thank you.
And that alone at the great wedding feast. I think we can worship now. Vince, you want to come up? Let's, I don't know, is this, would the sound be working, Clarence? It's all good to go. I think let's sing. Let's sing a song or two, and then we'll close the meeting by taking up an offering. And we'll just share a few announcements about what's coming up in the life of the church. Let's sing a song or two. Sorry, I just would like Kevin to share that word.
So I just felt during our first worship session, today is Palm Sunday, I'm not sure how many of you know that. And today is the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem. And so take 5 days from where Rory was. This was 5 days before the Garden of Gethsemane. And as Jesus is coming in to Jerusalem, all his followers are so excited because they recognize he's coming to save them. And as Jesus enters Jerusalem, it says Jesus caught sight of the city. I'm reading from the passage translation. It says he burst into tears with uncontrollable weeping, crying over Jerusalem, saying, if only you would recognize that this is the day of peace and it is within your reach. And what blows my mind is they were waving their palms and they were carrying on so excited, but they didn't have an understanding of what Jesus was actually coming to do. They thought he was coming to save them and take over and reign, take over the Romans and just reign. But Jesus' plan was so much bigger. But they understood scripture because Jesus riding in a donkey was from Zechariah. They knew that. But yet they chose not to understand the whole story. And I just felt this morning as we are so privileged because we know the whole story. We know the whole story. We know the finished work of the cross. And that Yet we still stand here and we don't praise as well as much as them, raising their palms and so excited that Jesus has arrived. Yet they just thought it was just for a moment in time, yet we know that Jesus came for eternity. What was going to happen the week after was for eternity. And so I just felt encouraged, and as I had a picture just in my mind of us just raising our hands, all of us, and waving them as palms.
Yeah, good.
And that is just like palms of just waving. And even if raising your hand is uncomfortable, maybe just put your one finger up.
Yeah,
just get out your comfort zone, because Jesus, what they were doing was just excitement for just a moment in time. But we've got eternity.
Yeah.
We have an understanding. And we mustn't be apathetic and take it for granted.
Yeah, so let's put our palms up. Let's put our palms up for this great King.
You are worthy of it all, sorry.
May we leave here today. Loving the Lord our God with all our hearts, with all our soul, with all our mind, and all our strength. Bearing a load for others sometimes in a sacrificial way, but obedient to the will of God. Even though at times we might not see the reward, it is a God who promises great reward to us. We obtain a reward because Jesus went into the furnace for us.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
And obeyed about a tree. And may we love our neighbors, even though they might be sleeping on us and bailed. May we love those around us, in spite of following the model of Jesus, but obeying our Father's will. To love them nonetheless. And lastly, will you bow your heads? Bow your heads and close your eyes. Does anybody want to choose the right cup today? If you've never made that choice in your life, there's a cup you need to choose. It's the cup of great joy. It's a cup of eternal life.
Hallelujah.
And Jesus says, I drank
Amen.
The cup of judicial wrath so that I can give you the cup of eternal life.
Thank you.
Whether you're young or older, this makes sense to you. Please, will you just raise your hand? Raise your hand and receive. Receive the cup of great joy. The psalmist would write, my cup overflows. In the midst of my enemies, your cup will overflow when you be blessed. Amen. Please, why don't you just take a seat? I just want to take up the offering. Can I have two volunteers, please? Paul, won't you come up and just take the basket on that side? And I'm in the dark there. Kelvin, thank you so much. I'm just going to run through a few things coming up. We'll speak into the redwood trees. If you can get those announcements up over. The redwood trees, we don't have time today, so I will do that another time, maybe Friday. But I just want to get some announcements coming up. So next weekend is Easter weekend. It's a great opportunity to invite friends into our family. This is truly a remarkable salvation. We carry the best news of the world.
Amen.
For all eternity. There will never be greater news than this. And Easter is a time when people need to come and hear the good news. We're running a Good Friday service. That will be 9 o'clock. And Easter Sunday service, 9 o'clock. That's this coming Friday. Just on the Friday, there will be no tea and coffee. Because people might have places to be and families to connect with. And so we're just running the service. For those who want to linger and have a chat, that's fine. But we're not going to do tea and coffee for the serving teams. But on Easter Sunday, undoubtedly, we will have tea and coffee, and that will be there. And then just coming up in May, on the 14th of May, is that right? Is that Mother's Day? 14th of May is Mother's Day. We go all out on Mother's Day. We don't just celebrate mothers, but we celebrate women. And how Jesus valued women, and how God loves women. And we celebrate their role in the life of our family. So from young to old, we want as many of the ladies to become encouraged in their faith. On Mother's Day, that's the 14th of May. And then there's going to be a ladies' breakfast on the 3rd of June. Is that right? That's a Saturday morning, so start to gear yourselves for that. I know the men have done a few things, but ladies, this is your moment. Okay, we want to pack this hall out. Leanne's going to plan and put a team together and for that ladies' breakfast. So can I suggest if somebody wants to volunteer to help on the morning, they come and speak with you. Is that right? Okay, and you can help her put it together. But we really want to plan an amazing sort of ladies' breakfast. Maybe include a bit of worship. I don't know. I'm not going to get involved. I said, don't get involved in those things. That's for them to plan. And they'll do it their way. So that is really good. So those are just two things. I just wanted to speak the Easter weekend, Mother's Day, and then the 3rd of June, and we'll speak about the redwood trees on another day. Father, thank you that we could gather in such a way. You're such a gracious God. You exhort us at times, but you like your sons and daughters, you press near. Sometimes when we've just drifted and we're distracted, but you pull us close. And I pray today, because of what you've done, Jesus, we can be so close to you, God our Father in heaven. And we can draw such strength from you. Amen. Let's go and have some tea and coffee. Thanks. Oh. Last week Wednesday, there was a birthday. Can everybody say happy birthday? Next week.